Good morning, church. I hope and pray that all is well. Before we do anything else, would you begin in prayer with me? Let us pray. Father, I ask that during this time, that you'd allow us to set aside all the things that distract us, all the things that are worrying us, all the things that keep us from you, and allow us to focus on you. Soften our hearts, soften our minds, so that we can gather in this place to worship, so that wherever we are, whatever we are doing, that your grace may be made evident in our lives, that your Spirit will fill us up. So come, Holy Spirit, now. Pour out yourself upon us in a fresh and new way. We ask these things in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Well, church, if you have been watching this online for the last couple of weeks, you may have noticed that we had a couple of technical difficulties. A couple of weeks ago, we had some sound that didn't start for a little bit. Last week, there was a slight buzzing sound. Know that the more I've thought and prayed about this, and the more that we have talked as a worship staff, I'm beginning to view more and more of our virtual viewers as a virtual campus and less of just something else. So last year, as we did two services during the summer, we did a traditional service and a contemporary service. I'm beginning to look more and more at it as we do an in-person worship service and we do a virtual worship service. Now, that doesn't mean that the virtual service is going to be vastly different than what we do in person. But what it does mean is that we're going to delay things a little bit so that each week you'll be actually watching the service from the week before. This week's service is actually a special service just for you, talking about worshiping at home and how that impacts us. I'm going to try to rearrange the prayer time so that it's more about how you pray at home and less about the, hear our prayer, because I know for many of you, it's almost inaudible completely to hear what other people were saying during that prayer time. And I just want to make sure that you are staying engaged in worship. And so this is a process that we're continually trying. So if there are any things that we can do to improve it, please let us know. But we hope that in the midst of this continued COVID crisis, that you are able to experience the grace and love of our Lord Jesus Christ in all times and in all places, and especially here during worship with us. The first screen, and you'll read the second screen that's bolded, all right? So I lift up my eyes to the hills. From whence does my help come? The Lord will not let your foot be moved. The Lord who keeps you will not slumber. Go back one, Anthony. There you go. The Lord is your keeper.
The Lord is your shade on the right hand.
The sun shall not smite you by day. The Lord will keep you from all evil and will keep your life.
The Lord will keep you from all evil and your coming in from this time forth and forevermore.
Our opening song today is Great is Thy Faithfulness, and since we're not using hymnals except me, the words are on the screen.
Thank you.
Yes.
for our virtual service. I want us to look at things just a little bit differently. I have several people that are close to my heart that have been sick or ailing, and I just want us to take time to pray for those that are in need of physical healing today. And so as you're watching online, as you're praying at home, what I'm going to do is I'm going to list off several names, and then I'm going to give us about 30 to 60 seconds at home so that you can pray, so that you can lift off, so that you can pray for people that you know that need prayers. And then we will all close together like normal, saying the Lord's Prayer. And so if you would, please join me in prayer as we pray for those that are sick and ailing during this time. Father, we live in a world ravaged with sickness and disease. There are so many people close to my heart, close to the hearts of people in this congregation that have gone through such trying times, sickness, death, and disease during this, that I just pray that you would be with everybody that we're lifting up to you during this time. And from the people closest to my heart, my dad, who will be having heart surgery this week, to Patty Buffington and John Buffington, to Barrett Covington, to Patty McLeod, to those in our community that have been in contact with people with COVID, to those that have COVID, to those that have a multiple array of other sicknesses, but their healthcare process has just been delayed or messed up because of all of this. God, hear our prayer. And during this time, I encourage those of you at home to pray for those that you know and love. Father, we ask these things, and all things bring the prayer that you taught us to say. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. For thine is the kingdom, power, and the glory forever. Amen. If you would, please rise and join me as we recite the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the resurrection of souls, the resurrection of body, and the life everlasting. Thank you. Lovely is your dwelling place, O Lord of hosts. My soul longs, indeed it faints, for the courts of the Lord. My heart and my flesh sing for joy to the living God. Even the sparrow finds a home, and the swallow a nest for herself, where she may lay her young. At your altars, O Lord of hosts, my King and my God. Happy are those who live in your house, ever singing your praise. Happy are those whose strength is in you, and whose heart are the highways of Zion. As they go through the valley of Baca, they make it a place of springs. The early rain also covers it with pools. They go from strength to strength. The God of gods will be seen in Zion. O Lord, God of hosts, hear my prayer. Give ear to me, O God, O Jacob. Behold our shield, O God. Look on the face of your anointed. For a day in your courts is better than 1,000 elsewhere. I would rather be a doorkeeper in the house of my God than live in the tents of wickedness. For the Lord God is a sun and shield. He bestows favor and honor. No good thing does the Lord withhold from those who walk uprightly. O Lord of hosts, happy is everyone who trusts in you. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. And if you would, continue in an attitude of prayer with me. Father, I ask that during this time, that you would come and soften the hearts of your children and open their ears. And I ask that you allow the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart to be pleasing and acceptable to you, O Lord, my rock and my redeemer. Amen. Worship has changed, especially for those of you that are sitting at home right now watching this virtually, which is all of you because I'm recording this specifically for those of you that are watching at home. Worship has changed since March. We were able to gather together in a large group, sing praises together without masks, not be leery of gathering in groups and who may or may not have COVID right now. Worship has changed. Some of you, in fact, right now are probably sitting in a Lazy Boy or on a couch with your feet up, relaxing, sipping a glass of tea, watching me in your pajamas. Worship has changed. Some of you may even fall asleep during the sermon right now. Okay, so maybe worship hasn't changed that much. Just kidding. I hope that you're not sleeping during the service. But for many of us, worship has changed. And I wholeheartedly believe, as I have said many times before, that the primary purpose of the church is for us to worship God. Worship is seen from the beginning of the New Testament to the end of the New Testament. We see it in Matthew chapter 2, when the wise men come and they visit Jesus. What do? They bow down, they worship Jesus, and they give him gifts of gold and frankincense of myrrh. These gifts represent the best of what Jesus had. When they are going to worship Jesus, they take Jesus their absolute best. And so it makes me wonder, when you come to worship God, especially virtually, are you bringing God your best to worship him? Or do you just approach it like another show on Netflix that you can turn on and off when you want to? That, yeah, I've got my phone over here, and oh, check out the news, or what's somebody doing on Facebook, or oh, look over here, or oh, what are the kids doing now? I can't hear because they're off in the background. A lot of times, I know when we worship virtually, it's easier for us to have three or four things going on at once. I know it because that's honestly what I would do a couple of times when I was worshiping virtually at home with some other churches. By us worshiping virtually, I'm going to ask you to bring the best of what you have to God for that 45 minutes to an hour. That means, just like in a normal worship service, that you would turn off your cell phones, turn off any other screens, and free yourself from distractions. If the kids can't sit still for 45 minutes and watch me, which I completely understand because I know that sometimes that's difficult for my kiddos to do, then engage them in some other way. Download some Christian material for them to do. Get some age-appropriate stuff. If you don't know what that means or looks like for them, please approach me and I will help you find some of that stuff. But when we worship, just like the wise men, we need to bring our best to God. So we see worship at the beginning of the Gospels in Matthew chapter 2, and we see worship at the very end of the New Testament in Revelation 22, when the whole world has been recreated in its divine final image and the divine restoration of creation. It says that we will be together worshiping God. So that is the very last picture the Bible has for us, is us gathering as a people of God, worshiping Him. Worship is vital for the life of the church. Worship is vital to the life of believers. And worship isn't about style. So how fast things are, what kind of liturgy we have, what we don't have. It's not about music, whether it's traditional, you know, playing on the piano like we typically do, or contemporary with the guitar, or pipe organs, or harmonicas, or anything else. It's not about what instruments we're using during worship. It's not about your clothes. So can you worship God in pajamas? Yes, you can. Now for some of you, you may feel that you need to put on a certain type of clothing to come to worship, and you just do what you need to do to feel comfortable to worship God. But worship isn't about your music, and it's not even about where you are, right? We see in the 84th Psalm that they're coming to worship God at the temple. But we live in a time of the Holy Spirit, so it doesn't matter where you're worshiping God at. You can worship God just as much and just as intimately in your house, in the woods, as you could if you're worshiping here with other people. Now, is it different? Yes. But that doesn't mean that you can't worship God anywhere that you're at. Worship has continued to change. Worship, at its root, is us giving God His proper worth, His proper value. As N.T. Wright says, worship is really worth-ship. It's placing the correct worth and value on God. And just think about it for a second. Think about who God is. We see in Genesis chapter 1 that God is the creator of the heavens and the earth, of all that is seen and all that is unseen. We see that He is the covenant-making God with Abraham and that He does not break His covenants. He does not break His promises. We see in Exodus that God is the God that liberates the people. He frees His people from bondage and He frees us in the same way. We see that God anoints people to do certain tasks in the kings of the Old Testament. We see that God comes and lives and dwells among us in the person of Jesus Christ. That He has come to defeat sin and death. And that Christ will come again. Our God is an amazing God that has transformed my life. And Lord willing, He has transformed your life as well. God is above all things, in all things, through all things. He is our head, the head of the church. Our source of life and substance. The giver of all that is good. The forgiver of sins. The reconciler of people. Our God is worthy of our praise. And that is what worship is about. It is about us coming to God and saying, God, this is who You are. And I'm not that. Because I know for some of us, it's easy for us to think, man, I am all that in a bag of chips. But in worship, it's about us giving God His proper worth, His proper value. In the Old Testament, worship literally meant that you bow down and that you prostrate yourself before God. It was an act of complete submission, an act of complete surrender, an act of humility saying that I am not worthy. Right? And if you remember the story of Moses, Moses wants to see God face to face. And God says, look, you can't see me face to face and survive. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to pass by you. And after I pass by, then you can glance out. And so God passes by Moses, and Moses gets a glance of God's backside glory, and man, he has changed forevermore because he understands the magnitude and magnificence of who the Creator is, of who his Redeemer is. That is worship. He is prostrating himself. He is coming to God saying, "You are worthy." And we as God's people need to continue to worship him with the best of what we have, declaring his worth and praise. And we see this clearly in the 84th Psalm. It says, "How lovely is your dwelling place, O Lord of hosts! My soul longs, indeed it faints, for the courts of the Lord. My heart and my flesh sing for joy to the living God. Even the sparrow finds a home, and the swallow a nest for herself, where she may lay her young. You're at your altars, O Lord of hosts, my King and my God. Happy are those who live in your house, ever singing your praise." One of the great things about this text is that it's talking about people going to the temple to worship God. Now you have to understand that in the Old Testament, this is what people would do, is people would travel into Jerusalem because that was the temple of God, that is literally the house where God dwelt at in the Holy of Holies on the altar of the covenant, and that they would go and worship him. That was the only place they could make sacrifice. It was the place where heaven and earth intersected. But now, as people of the new covenant, as people in the new creation, as people that are living under the power of the Holy Spirit, we realize that the Holy Spirit doesn't just live in the sanctuary that we worship him in. Praise be to God, because the sanctuary here, Community United Methodist Church, was torn down 6 years ago. And if God didn't show up in this warehouse, man, we'd be in a heap of trouble. And if God didn't show up in your house, we'd be in a heap of trouble. Because we don't have to go to a specific place to worship God. No, we can worship him anytime, any place. This means at home, in nature, in your car, in your shower. And what is this verse saying? It is saying, sing your praise. When we worship, especially when we are worshiping virtually, I want to encourage you to engage with us in singing. Now think about it. What other time in your life do you have the chance to just bust out these hymns that we're singing at the top of your lungs and not have to worry about anybody else judging you? I know that when I worship here in church with people present, that I like to kind of lower my voice a little bit, because when I sing, I'm afraid that people are going to hear me and they're going to realize that sometimes I cannot carry a tune in a bucket. And then they'll be like, "Man, how come that preacher can't preach or can't sing? Why? What's that awful sound coming from?" "Oh, that's just the preacher. We know how bad he sings, right?" So at your house, you can sing with no judgment. You can sing with all your heart, all your might. And since we can worship God anywhere, that means that we can sing not just in worship, which I strongly encourage you to do, but we can sing to God and his praises anytime and anywhere. You can sing praise and worship in the choir or in the shower. Not in the choir right now. My choir has been temporarily banned up. My bad. But you can praise him in the shower. You can praise him in bed. You can praise him in the car. You can praise him on a walk. You can praise him as you're cooking supper. You can praise him and sing his praises. And one of the great things about singing by yourself is that you can sing the music that touches your heart and your soul. Whether it's Elvis Presley singing "In the Garden," you can turn that on. To Hillsong, singing Waymaker, with a variety of platforms from Amazon Music and Apple Music and Pandora and YouTube, you can listen to almost any song at any given time. We need to be a people that continue to worship God in song. The psalmist continues in verses 5 to 8, and it says, "Happy are those whose strength is in you, in whose heart are the highways to Zion. As they go through the valley of Baca, they make it a place of springs. The early rain also covers it with pools. They go forth from strength to strength. The God of gods will be seen in Zion. The Lord of hosts will hear my prayer. Give ear, O God of Jacob." It says that as we are worshiping God, we get stronger and stronger because we're drawing closer to him. And that God will hear our prayer. And as I said earlier in this service, I know that the prayer time virtually is different. but I strongly encourage you to continue to engage with us in prayer. So I'm going to try my best as your pastor to lead that prayer time virtually in a way that will engage you at home, to give you the time and the space to take a minute or two to approach the throne of God in prayer. We have multiple ways for you to continue to engage us while you're watching virtually in prayer. You can, during the prayer time, if you're watching on our YouTube channel, use the chat function and say, "This is a prayer request. Would y'all pray for me?" You can shoot me an email or a text message and say, "Hey, Dustin, would you pray for this? And let me know, because we long to be a church that prays alongside you, that prays with you." You can even go to our Facebook page. It's something that I'm thinking about, hopefully we'll start relatively soon, as a specific Facebook page for community UMC prayers, that people can just go on and put, "This is my prayer request." It'll be a closed, private group where not everybody in the Facebook world can see it, but you can share freely how we can pray for you as a church. And not just praying during church, but we need to be a people that pray at all times and all places. And as many of us aren't gathering to worship at home, this is a great time for you to help your spouse or your children or some friends learn what it means to pray. I encourage you to take time each and every day to pray, not just by yourself, but with people that surround you, whether it be your kids or your wife, or whether you're a widow at home watching this. Then find a neighbor, find a person in the church that you know, that you trust, and say, "How can we pray for one another today?" Just give them a call up and say, "Let us pray together," because we need to be a people of prayer. The psalmist continues in verses 9 and 10. "Behold our shield, O God, look on the face of your anointed, for a day in your courts is better than 1,000 elsewhere." One day in your courts is better than 1,000 elsewhere. One day in the temple of God, what the psalmist was saying, one day there is better than 3 years spent anywhere else. 1 hour, Lord willing, in worship for 45 minutes is better than the rest of the time you can spend your week. And that is our hope and our goal, is that this 45 minutes, this hour that we gather together to worship God together virtually, that will be blessing and an instrument to your soul, that it will be the best way that you can spend an hour of that week, so that you can engage with God, see the children of God, worshiping God. Because that is what we want, is we want for you to enter His courts with thanksgiving and enter His courts with praise. We want you to be blessed because you are being able to worship God with His church, even though it looks vastly different than it has in the past. One day is better than 1,000 elsewhere. And one of the things that the psalmist doesn't talk about, but that I want to mention specifically, is I know that a lot of us are missing the community that we have built up here. That while worshiping online is a good alternative, that it's not the same as worshiping in person. And for many of you I know who aren't going to be coming back anytime soon, one of my biggest pastoral concerns is that you're doing it all alone. Remember in Genesis, the first thing the Bible says that is not good, it's before sin enters the world, is Adam is alone. God looks at Adam and says, "It is not good for man to be alone." It is not good for you to be alone. It is not good for you to do everything in life alone. And so while you may not be able to gather us in person to worship, what you can do is you can do certain things together. God bless the technology that we have to us today. Whether it be from the camera that I'm recording you on, to my cell phone where you can FaceTime people, to Zoom where you can see a group of 8 to 10 people, please do not do life alone. Do not do worship alone. While you may need to watch it alone for safety purposes, call and say, "Hey, Sue, this is Dustin, and I'm going to be watching worship today at 11. Are you going to be watching it too?" And then after the service, contact her and say, "Hey man, that sermon was, you know, it wasn't his best sermon." Or want y'all to be able to do life together, to know what's going on with one another's lives, to not just worship together, but to be able to pray together, to be able to disciple one another together, to be able to know that you are not alone. And that is who we are. That is the name of our congregation. It is Community United Methodist Church, because you need to know that you are not alone. And if you're not sure if you have anyone who can do this with you, who can worship with you, who can pray with you, who can disciple with you, please do not hesitate to reach out to me. Because worship is so much more than just me and God. Christianity is so much more than me and God. It is about our relationship as a congregation, as a people with God, us worshiping God together. And I know now more than ever, we need that connectivity. We need that fellowship with other believers. And so let us worship Him together. Worship is bringing our best to God, setting aside times and places that it is us giving thanks and praise to the God, the Creator of the heavens and the universe. And so I urge you, whatever you're doing, that you make sure that you take time each day, each week, to spend in worship with God, because better is one day in His courts than 1,000 elsewhere. Better is 5 minutes worshiping God one day than the rest of the day to put together, when we enter into His presence with an attitude of praise and thanksgiving. We bring our best to Him. We give Him our heart, our soul, our mind, and our strength. All that we have and all that we are. That is us worshiping down to God, telling Him He is in control and we aren't. Will you continue to be a people of worship with me during this time? Let us pray. Father, I ask that you continue to lead and guide us as a congregation, that you would give us an attitude of worship, that we would continually praise you and put you in your right place, Father, Creator, Sustainer, Redeemer, Salvation. That you would allow us to praise you and thank you, that you would be with our songs, be with our prayers, be with our voices, be with our relationships as we pour out our lives to you. Help us to worship you in this time. We ask these things in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen and amen. And if you would, please join Melba in song.
Please stand as we sing our closing song, "'Tis So Sweet to Trust in Jesus."
Thank you.
countenance unto you and give you peace. May you go in the grace and the peace of our Lord Jesus Christ. May be with you now and forevermore. Amen.
Amen.